morning, everyone. I don't know if you guys all saw the video, but definitely happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there and grandmas and women who have poured yourselves into so many precious lives. I know I'm grateful and thankful to be a mom and grateful and thankful for my mom. So if you guys would stand, we're going to go ahead and bless the Lord this morning. So.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship His holy name.
Happy Mother's Day to you. And I wanted to just share with you some announcements this morning. When you came in, make sure, or hopefully you got two green pieces of paper. If you didn't, this is not the Mother's Day gift, by the way. If you didn't get a couple of these, whether you're a lady or a gentleman. Make sure that you get one. You can either go to the back and get one, or you can tell an usher when they're coming by for the offering. Just say, could you give me a couple of these when you're done with the offering? And that'll be great. We're going to use these later. I know that you're just really excited about that. So, but speaking of Mother's Day and Mother's Day gifts, we would like to offer to the ladies as you're leaving today, we do have a gift, a small gift for you as you leave. So make sure you pick one of those up on the way out. If you're visiting with us this morning, we would encourage you to fill out a Connect card that you will find in the bench in front of you. So please just fill one of those out, and you can put it in the offering plate, or you can take it to the Welcome Center on your way out, and that will really help us as we try to get to know you. If there's anything that you have a question about, anything you'd like to learn more about, just fill one of those out for us, please. Now, we also want to let you know that there's an opportunity to learn more about our church, what we believe in, who we are, how we're organized, what our convictions are, and what does it mean to be a member of the church. So we're having a Church of the Nazarene 101 class on Tuesday, May 23rd at 6:30 p.m. It will be in the classroom over here just off the lobby, and you're welcome to join us whether you're a member or not. If you're just wanting to learn more about our church, or if you just want to spend time with people talking about what our church believes, you are more than welcome to join us on this evening as we explore. If too many people come, we'll just move to another room. It'll be all right. There's enough room for you. So come on and learn more about our church. Whether you're going to become a member or not, you're welcome to come and learn more. So please consider joining us for that. Now, if you do become a member, you will be able to participate in our church elections. All of our members, all of our official church members, are invited to vote across two Sundays, just once, not both Sundays, before or after, not both times. The service in the lobby will have a little ballot station set up. We are electing positions, people to positions on the board, positions of leadership, delegates to the assembly, things like that. So make sure that you come those weeks and vote if you are a member. And our new members that decide to become members after the membership class will be able to take advantage of that the following Sunday as well. We want to let you know that this week we are having a rummage sale. There is a rummage sale that will be taking place at our fellowship hall on Friday from 8 to 4 and Saturday from 8 to 2. And this will go to benefit the teens that are going to Nazarene Youth Conference in Tampa Bay. In just a couple months, they're going to be going to Tampa Bay. And they will be joining Nazarenes from all over the U.S. and Canada. Thousands of Nazarene young people all in one room. It's quite the experience. It's quite the set-apart time to get to know God in a special way. So we want to support them. And this is one of the ways that we can get money from the community. We know a lot of people in this church have given to this as well. And we would like to give the whole community an opportunity to pay for it, right? So make sure that you share this, share about this event, and come and check it out. You might find someone else's trash might be your treasure. I wouldn't call any of it trash, though. We've got some nice things, collectibles, antiques, but also some practical items for any generation as well. If you'd like to help, you can donate Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Wednesday will have extended collection times, and you can also contact Barb Snyder or Carla Paris if you would like to help in a certain way as well. That would be wonderful. All right, we are going to take an offering, and we'll share some more things with you in a little bit, but we are going to take an offering this morning. This is for all the ministries of the church. It is something that God expects us to do, is to give from our resources for the work of his kingdom. And if you trust this church, if this is your church, then this is something that we do as an act of worship and an act of trust to God, saying, God, take this. Use it for your glory. Use it to reach people with your message. And so we will pray that God would bless this offering. Let us pray. God, We are so grateful to be in a set-apart place at a set-apart time, to get to know you, to sing your praises, to get to know the body of Christ. And so, God, as we come here, would you make yourself known amongst us? Would you be especially present, as we recognize that you are everywhere all the time, be especially present here, right now, with us. Let us know you very well today. Open our ears and our hearts for what you have in store for us. And take these gifts that we now give and use them for your purposes, not our own purposes. And give those who are making decisions about how it would be spent, give them wisdom and love at the center of their motivation. And God, would you build this church? You see where we are going in ways that we can't. So God, reveal to us your plan. Guide us by your hand and deliver a people in this community longing to know the freedom of the gospel. Build our lives, Lord, as we seek to become more and more like you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, the name above every name.
take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move.
Blessing for me personally to have my parents here today. It's been a while since I've been able to be with my mom on Mother's Day. But the Make Me a Servant song they sang at their wedding. And you didn't know that when you picked it out. I don't think I've ever told you that.
One of my favorites, too.
And it's a beautiful thing because my dad was ordained in the ministry, but my mother, as they became one, saw that they were both called to serve the Lord together. And that's what we are called to as well. We have a number of concerns in our church that we want to bring before the Lord, but we also want to ask God, what is my place in all of it? And that's the question we have today. What is my place in a world full of hurting people? So if you would like, come and sit, come and pray. You can come and kneel, you can come and sit, you can sit in your seat, you can stand. Whatever posture of prayer works for you. So come, let us pray. Oh God, we come before you, humble and meek, in a world that tells us not to be humble and meek, a world that tells us that everything should be all about us and what we want. And that's really my inclination. It's all of our inclinations by birth, is to seek what's best for us. Yet we have seen in you and in your Son, Jesus Christ, a type of selfless love, a love that has come not to be served, but to serve. And so, God, would you give us your heart? God, would you come and reside in our hearts? And may we be your hands and feet in this world, and may we see how, transformed by your love, we are able to love others as you have loved us. Perhaps we feel we aren't capable of that kind of love. Lord, in our weakness, be our strength. Lord, where we fall short, lift us up. Bring us where we need to be. Oh God, give us your grace. We can't do anything without your help. We cannot save ourselves. We cannot fix our situations. We are powerless. As we step out of denial, God, may we see the path towards victory. May we see the path towards redemption in our lives. God, we think about those in our congregation, friends and family in our congregation, friends and family of our congregation. On Wednesday night, we had a whiteboard that was full of prayer concerns, mostly physical needs, people who are battling cancer, people who have had accidents this week, people who have very, very concerning diagnoses. And we also have prayer concerns for people who are lost, people who don't know you, people who do not know the salvation of the cross and the victory of the resurrection, people who will not believe. And God, we pray for all of these situations. We pray that you would move in your people, that you would bring healing, that you would bring comfort and relief, please, God. But also, God, we pray for the most important thing, that more people would know you, that people would see your face, that people would know your truth, that people would be able to trust you, that people would be able to see through all of the voices that try to describe who you are but are wrong. Let us see who you truly are. Let us see who you are in Scripture. And may we be a guiding light to our neighbors, to our sons and daughters and grandsons and granddaughters, aunts and uncles and cousins, mothers and fathers who are lost. May we be the voice of truth, and may we turn people towards you, God. Help us, oh God. So many times we are overwhelmed and are tempted to just check out. But God, would you grow in us a sensitivity, a peace with where we are and what we have to deal with, but also an awareness of what we can do about the broken world that we find ourselves in. So God, heal our bodies, heal our minds, and heal our hearts so that we might show the whole world that you are God and that the whole world might know you now and eternally. We thank you for your good gifts, God. We thank you for godly women. We thank you for godly men. We thank you for the family. And God, let us never take it for granted. And let us never take for granted what you have done for each of us individually as well as a group. May we find ourselves in your will, knowing you well, and seeing the hope that you give us. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. Hold on a second. I want to introduce this video first. If you could, turn to the book of Joel, chapter 1. We're going to read from there in a few minutes. But first, I want to show you a video. All right? Now we're good.
There is no other species on the planet that responds as quickly and as dramatically to the good times as the desert locust. Eggs that have remained in the ground for 20 years begin to hatch. The young locusts are known as hoppers, for at this stage they're flightless. They find new feeding grounds by following the smell of sprouting grass. Normally, it takes 4 weeks for hoppers to become adults, but when the conditions are right, as now, their development switches to the fast track. As the vegetation in one place begins to run out, the winged adults release pheromones, scent messages, which tell others in the group that they must move on. And when groups merge, they form a swarm. Locust eats its entire body weight every day, and a whole swarm can consume literally hundreds of tons of vegetation. They have to keep on moving. The swarm travels with the wind. It's the most energy-saving way of flying. Following the flow of wind means that they're always heading toward areas of low pressure. Places where wind meets rain and vegetation starts to grow. As they fly, swarms join up with other swarms to form gigantic plagues several billion strong and as much as 40 miles wide. They will consume every edible thing that lies in their path. Thank you. This is one of planet Earth's greatest spectacles. It's rarely seen on this scale, and it won't last long. Once the food has gone, the steady roar of a billion beating locust wings will once again be replaced by nothing more than the sound of the desert wind.
Hear this, you elders. Listen, all you who live in the land. Has anything like this ever happened in your days? Or in the days of your ancestors? Tell it to your children, and let your children tell it to their children, and their children to the next generation. What the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. What the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. Wake up, you drunkards, and weep. Wail, all you drinkers of wine. Wail because of the new wine, for it has been snatched from your lips. A nation has invaded my land, a mighty army without number. It has the teeth of a lion, the fangs of a lioness. It has laid waste my vines and ruined my fig trees. It has stripped off their bark and thrown it away, leaving their branches white. Mourn like a virgin in sackcloth, grieving for the betrothed of her youth. Grain offerings and drink offerings are cut off from the house of the Lord. The priests are in mourning, those who minister before the Lord. The fields are ruined, the ground is dried up, the grain destroyed, the new wine is dried up. The olive oil fails. Despair, you farmers. Wail, you vine growers. Grieve for the wheat and the barley, because the harvest of the field is destroyed. The vine is dried up, and the fig tree is withered. The pomegranate, the palm, and the apple tree, all the trees of the field are dried up. Surely the people's joy is withered away. And that's Joel chapter 1, verse 1 through 12. Now, some of you were expecting a Mother's Day sermon today. And you are going to get one, because today is Mother's Day, and this is the sermon. But in this chapter, we are reading a situation of devastation. Somebody's looking around at their land, their community, and seeing the havoc that has been reaped by a swarm of locusts like what you saw in that video. And this is what they say. Tell it to your children and their children and their children. So what's a children's children? Grandchildren, right? Tell it to your grandchildren. Tell it to your great-grandchildren. And you tell it to each other, too. The stories, right? How many people grew up in Weirton, in this valley, or in Steubenville, in this area? How many people worked in the steel mill? How many people go and tell the stories to the people, their children and their grandchildren and their great-grandchildren of what this valley used to be? You drive up Main Street today and you think about what used to be, for better or worse, right? You see what's missing that used to be there. And sometimes it causes us to grieve, right? There used to be a booming economy. There used to be a lot to do. There used to be like all kinds of jobs, life, young families, all over the place. And sometimes you can just hear, and when people talk, this hint of sadness, of missing what there used to be. And they tell it to their children, and to their children's children, and to their children's children, and to the next generation. Now, how many of you have locusts at home, like pet locusts, right? You keep them at home? Nobody? No? You keep them for farm for food? You know, they're really good sources of protein, so I hear, pretty efficient, you know. In this passage, in verse 4, where we read what the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten, what the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten, and what the young locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. And when you actually read the Hebrew, there's what's going on here is four different names for locusts. And we're not 100% sure what the distinction is, but the first one is, it says what the gazam or gazam locusts have left, the arba locusts have eaten. What the arba locusts left, the yalek have eaten. And what the yalek have left, the hehesil has eaten. Depending on what translation, they handle this a few different ways, whether it's different species or different developments or just the four different words for the same thing. In the Akkadian language, they had 18 different words for locust. So we're doing pretty well with just four. If you read the King James Version, the first one is the palmer worm, which is like a moth. And then they say the locust for arba. And then for yolek, they say the canker worm, which I had never heard of. And then they say that the hehesil is a caterpillar. But whatever way you translate this, what is clear is that this plague has happened. And as we learned from that video, the wind carries in the locusts to wherever is good, and they devastate. They eat it up, and they leave a lot of damage. A locust has a 90-day span in which they can eat their own weight in one day, and 1 billion locusts can eat as much as 1,250 elephants. And a single female laying eggs in June, one single female locust that lays eggs in June could result in 18 million offspring within 4 months. I told you this was a Mother's Day sermon. And it can be really serious stuff, really devastating. In 1915, in the Ottoman-Syrian plague of locusts, there was a great famine. And the location of Mount Lebanon, they went from 400,000 people in their population to 200,000 in 3 years because of the effect on the harvest of the land. Not only that, but in that time, there was also a world war going on. And so trade routes were a problem during that time, leading to even more problems, more starvation, more famine. In fact, what they did, they said, what are we going to do about this? So they would use flamethrowers to actually burn up a lot of the locusts. And they actually made a law that every man between the ages of 15 and 60 had to go out and collect 20 kilograms of locust eggs, or they would have to pay a fine. Talk about an Easter egg hunt. And they, at one point during that plague, they thought, oh, they've all gone away. But then the larva hatched, and they had even more. So you can really see in even modern day history, a plague like this can really take its toll. It comes and comes and comes. What one left, the next eight. Later on in this passage, verse 12, it ends with, surely the people's joy is withered away. You think about joy. You've heard people talk about joy before. What's the difference between joy and happiness, right? Things that make you happy for a moment might not actually provide lasting joy. You can imagine, like, if somebody from 100 years ago was transported by a time machine to today, how overwhelmed with joy they would be at the things that they could afford, at the effort that would go into life. Think about people from 300 years ago that don't have to farm or toil, at the convenience that is before us, that we can access all the information in the world from our phone. Isn't that incredible? We should be overjoyed. We have everything we ever need to make life more convenient and more happy. But would you say that the general joy in the U.S. population has increased or decreased? Well, how come? Well, that's one perspective. You look at everything around us, all the tools that we have, all the problems that we have, we say, we should know more than we ever do before about how to fix all the problems that are surrounding us, but yet we still have the problems and they seem to be getting worse. One particular issue in our community that I want to just highlight as an example, it's not the only example, it's not the only issue. I'm missing my black marker, if anybody's ever seen it around here somewhere. I can't find it. But hopefully you can read this and let me know if I need to adjust it. It's a big black marker, not just any black marker. Sorry. But seriously, there is something really devastating going on right now. Right here, like in our city, in our state, in our valley. It's drugs. Like, how can we ignore this? So whether it's meth and things like that, or what started to become a problem in the mid to late 90s, which was the prescription opioid crisis, right? And then around 2010, what really started taking over was something that starts with an H, heroin. And now, fentanyl, right? You guys familiar with this? And people say, why aren't we talking about this more? I'm not sure I'm spelling that right. This is huge. Like, this is, like, really bad right now. The leading death of people ages 25 to 44 in the USA went from overdoses. Opioid overdose went from 3 out of every 100,000 in 1999 to 21 out of every 100,000 in 2020. That's a sevenfold increase in death, in the death rate. And do you know which state has the highest death rate? West Virginia. And it's not even close. Washington, D.C. is the next one, and it's several percentage points less. West Virginia has an 81.4% death rate from opioid overdose. And Ohio is fifth place. And that one's in the 40%, 40s. Like, this is really bad. You guys recognize that? But we're not talking about it. At least I don't hear people talking about it much. And you can read all kinds of things about what we see is wrong. And they have all kinds of suggestions for what are we going to do about it. Well, maybe we just need more jobs. Maybe that would help. Well, it might help, right? Or maybe we need more health care for the people that are struggling with addiction. And that would help. That would help, right? Maybe we need more better punishment and penalties for the people that are providing access to these things. Well, that might help too. There's a lot of things that could help, but it's kind of like a beard that just keeps growing. And we've got more programs than ever before, right? More knowledge, more access to help than ever before, and yet the problem keeps growing. Perhaps we need a fresh wind. If you continue reading in Joel, in the book of Joel, the rest of chapter 2, I'm not going to read it word for word, but he talks about mourning, talks about how they're not able to perform the sacrifices. If you can't perform the sacrifices because you don't have the offerings to provide, how are you going to experience the blessing, the way that their worship works? The food has been cut off. Then going on to chapter 2, sorry, the end of chapter 1 was about that. Going into chapter 2, it starts to talk about an army. And what's unclear is if we're talking about an army of locusts or if we're talking about an actual army that's coming and devastating the land. And either way, the two have very similar effects. Devastation, loss of crops, loss of life. It's crippling. Either way. So the army, whether it's an army or whether it's a swarm of locusts, is devastating the land, and they're watching this going on before them. But let's read chapter 2, verses 12 through 15. Joel 2, 12 through 15. Even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting and weeping and mourning. Rend your heart and not your garments. We talked about this a few weeks ago. When people are mourning, especially grieving the loss, they'll tear their garments. It's like a way of identifying with those whose clothes are decaying in the ground. Rend your heart and not your garments. Let your mourning go deeper, all the way down within. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love, and he relents from sending calamity. Who knows? He may turn and relent and leave behind a blessing, grain offerings and drink offerings for the Lord your God. It's interesting here, too, that we might look at what's going on in our land, the things that are devastating us. We might say, well, is that God's punishment for something? Like, their understanding a lot of times is that God would send the plagues. God would send the armies. Do we have that now? We don't know. We don't know. But whatever it is, we want him to intervene. We need to invite God to intervene, whether he sent it as a punishment or if it's a result of a broken world or if it's a result of a people not responding to what God is calling us to do. Verse 15, blow the trumpet in Zion, declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly. Now that's interesting. How do you ask a people to fast who doesn't have food to begin with? Right? We kind of been fasting by default, Lord. We don't have food to eat. Declare a holy fast. Okay, you found yourself in a place of need. You found yourself in a place of want. Set it apart for God. What circumstances have you found yourself in where you feel like you don't have everything you need to do life right? You don't have everything you need to do life with God right. You don't have everything you need to be able to encounter the Bible in meaningful ways. God, I don't feel you. God, I'm struggling with my faith. God, I'm struggling with sin. Say, in that brokenness, in that barrenness, dedicate it to God. And say, God, here I am. I'm broken. I don't have anything to work with. Come and respond, God. Help me, God. Fill up the places where I am empty. Because that's the purpose of a fast, is to say, here, I'm going to be empty so God can fill me. These are things that I think I need, and I really do need. But I need God even more. That's right. Amen. So the question is, how can we be blessed by our worship when we don't have the things to offer? We don't have the time, we don't have the money, we don't have the health. And then how do we fast? How do we set apart this time for God to do something? What do we do when we see a community desperately in need of God? And so after the people turn to God, we see a description of God in chapter 2, starting with verse 18, the Lord's answer. Then the Lord was jealous for his land and took pity on his people. Some people get hung up on the word jealous. How could God be a jealous God? He's jealous for me. You say, what? We're not supposed to be jealous, right? But God is the creator. Everything belongs to him. When you are jealous for something that rightfully belongs to you, that's different than envying something that doesn't belong to you. Is God jealous for our land? You might read this and you think, well, this is talking about the people of Judah. This is talking about people that were in the promised land. This is God's special people. It was a theocracy. It was a government that was based around the following of the Lord, right? So, of course, this is his land. And America's a little bit different, right? This is not a theocracy as much as we might hope that it would be. But is God not still jealous for this land? Is not the whole earth his? Are we not living in the new covenant where we recognize that all people are called to be God's people? He's jealous for this land. Let's recognize that. Will he take pity on his people that are living in this land that he's jealous for? Well, certainly. Verse 19, the Lord replied to them, I am sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil, enough to satisfy you fully. Never again will I make you an object of scorn to the nations. I will drive the northern horde far from you, pushing it into a parched and barren land. Its eastern ranks will drown in the Dead Sea, and its western ranks in the Mediterranean Sea, and its stench will go up, its smell will rise. Surely he has done great things. Do not be afraid, land of Judah. Be glad and rejoice. Surely the Lord has done great things. Do not be afraid, you wild animals, for the pastures in the wilderness are becoming green. The trees are bearing their fruit. The fig tree and the vine yield their riches. Be glad, people of Zion. Rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given you autumn rains because he is faithful. He sends you abundant showers, both autumn and spring rains as before. The threshing floors will be filled with grain. The vats will overflow with new wine and oil. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. The gazam locusts, the great locusts, and the young locusts, the other locusts, and the locust swarm, the great army that I sent among you. You will have plenty to eat until you are full. And you will praise the name of the Lord your God, who has worked wonders for you. Never again will my people be shamed. Then you will know that I am in Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and that there is no other. Never again will my people be shamed. Can we hope for that? For our people? For our land? These promises of restoration, were they just for Judah? You might be able to make that argument as a Bible scholar. You might say God's not interested in what happens here. But do you remember what brings the locusts from one place to another? It's the wind. It's the wind. So God's going to send his wind to provide relief. In the 10 plagues in the Exodus story, Exodus chapter 10, you remember that one of the plagues was a plague of locusts. And when it's finally time for the plague of locusts to be over, a wind carries them away into the Red Sea, where they are drowned. In the Hebrew Bible, this is one of the most important words, I would say, for what my opinion's worth. One of the most important words that we are familiar with is the word ruach. Ruach. And it is a Hebrew word that means wind. It means breath or spirit. And then the New Testament, the word is pneuma, or they might have pronounced it pneuma. And you know what that word means? Wind, breath, and spirit. Will God send his fresh wind? Yes. So we read about the day of the Lord, verse 28. And afterward, I will pour out my ruach, spirit, wind, on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my ruach, my spirit, in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens, and on the earth blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be deliverance, as the Lord has said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. And you think, well, that doesn't sound like very much fun, right? What's blood and fire and billows of smoke, sun being turned into darkness and the moon to blood? The great and dreadful day of the Lord? Well, in a locust plague, a lot of times it could blot out the sun and the moon if it was thick enough. And what we'll recognize is in the great day of the Lord, in the times of testing, in the day of evil, but also in the day where the Lord is ready to do his great work among us, it's going to be a time where there's a lot of bad stuff going on. But at the same time, God will be made known in a really powerful way. So the locust swarm that comes, that's so devastating, so terrifying, so awful. We say, where is God? It's at that moment where it gets so awful, so terrible, when God shows up. And he shows up through his people. Acts chapter 2. I get all my weeks mixed up. You know, I messed up the Advent weeks and the Mother's Day. I preached a little bit of a Mother's Day sermon last week. And Pentecost isn't for another couple weeks. But here we are in Acts 2 where there's Pentecost. So you'll just have to forgive me. It's going to be all right. But Peter, Jesus has gone up to heaven. Jesus is no longer with them. They're waiting for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost comes. They're all together in one place, and there's a sound like the blowing of a violent wind comes from heaven and fills the whole house where they're sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, the Holy One, and began to speak in other tongues as the pneuma, Spirit, enabled them. And all these people from all over the place that were there for the Pentecost, they heard them speaking about the wonders of God in their own language. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, what is this all about? What's going on here? Some people said, well, they must be drunk. And Peter, what does he do? He stands up and he says, let me quote to you a passage from the book of Joel about the last days. Let me tell you about what God is going to do in this moment and what is happening, what you are experiencing. And he goes on in this beautiful sermon explaining how Jesus and his death and resurrection has fulfilled what they had been expecting. And in verse 36, Peter says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, who you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. And many accepted this message. If you read more, we're reading a lot of scripture today. Praise God. Verse 42, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Does the church of God experience the favor of all the people today? Why not? In our community, when people know that people are a part of this church, are they like, man, those people are so fortunate to belong to that people, that church? Do they see us breaking bread together in our homes? Do they see us doing things like that? Do they see us having a spirit of thanksgiving? Are we devoted to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, to prayer? Are we devoted to those things? Do we have the Holy Spirit? Because from what I can tell, I think that's what's going to make the difference in our community. But we don't expect it. Or we have some flawed expectations. Well, if the Holy Spirit would just come, then I'd be like a superhero. I'd be able to do miracles. I'd be able to never have any struggles or temptations. But it wasn't quite like that. You see that the Holy Spirit was with people. They were baptized with the Holy Spirit. But Peter still had some things to figure out. Right? You remember those stories? Peter still had some stuff to work out. It wasn't all the time big fancy shows. But what there was consistently was a deep fellowship and a deep conviction that God is with us. And we're with each other. Can you imagine what would happen in our valley if people saw us loving each other? If people saw unity within us so much? If we got outside these four walls? I mean, it's kind of cliche. We say things like this a lot, but what if people saw how different this alternative is? And that they saw, like, man, these people have something good. They're not going to be drawn to just good music or a good sermon or anything. Coffee? Nice bathrooms? They're going to be drawn towards something that they have to have in order to find joy. Where is it? Where is it? Let it be so, God. Let it start with us. And then we might see that as we get involved with the people that are hurting, as we go to the dark places, like you can see like videos online where there's whole communities where it seems like there's zombies. Like this stuff is a mess. Are there Christians going there? Or are we afraid? I'm not saying be foolish. Like, I'm not going to send my 5-year-old into a neighborhood and say, here, hand out some tracts. No. But there's got to be something. And what I see in the book of Acts is they didn't just stay in the temple. They went everywhere. We are the temple. We're the temple on wheels. We're the bookmobile. We can come to you. So you have two pieces of green paper, and I want you to know that these are leaves. Did you know that? I could have spent a lot more time cutting these into a shape, but I said this is going to do. And what I want you to do is I want you to hold these leaves, and I want you to think about your community. There's a lot of visitors here with us today that maybe aren't from this community. Think about your own community. And join us together in this moment as we pray and consider what our place is. We have been planted here. This is our place. This is our place to blossom and grow fruit, to be a blessing. But we've experienced some kind of loss in our community. I want you to think about, what is it in our community that you really want to see? Where do you want to see something change in our community? And you can write something like, I want more people to know Jesus. That's fine. That's totally fine. But it's not wrong if you write something different. Like, I want more children to know their fathers. I want more people to see how valuable the family unit is. I want people to know their neighbors. I want people to commit to the marriage covenant. I want people to not be on drugs. I want people to be healthy. Any of those things. And we're not coming up with the solution. We're not coming up with the pragmatic steps to take care of all these problems that we see, all the things that we want to change in here. But here's what we're going to do. We are going to write down what it is that you want to see change, something specific that you want to see happen in our community. And I want you to write it on both papers, the same thing. One, you're going to keep for yourself and put it somewhere where you're reminded to pray as often as every day for this, that God would reveal a way for his church to provide a solution or to be a part of the solution for this problem, okay? So one of them you keep for yourself. And the other one, we're going to come the praise team is going to come up and help us with this. They're going to sing, lead us in a song. And I want you to come, and whatever it is that you've written down in a moment, I want you to just lay on one of these altars up here and say, this is a leaf that we don't have right now. We don't have what we need to face this problem right now. But we're going to offer it to you, God. We're going to say, Lord, take this offering, and please, Lord, give us your Holy Spirit. And through your Holy Spirit, Lord, give us what we need. We're going to sing the song, Take My Life, again. But I would like to invite you to stand, and as they're singing, bring whatever need you have up here and give it to God. And feel free to pray, feel free to sing, whatever you would do. Thank you.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of the love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, none of my wood I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as you choose. Here am I. Treasure soul, take myself and I will be ever only all for thee. Here am I,
all of me,
take my life,
take my life,
it's all for thee,
it's all.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee.
We're going to pray, but I want to let you know about some opportunities that will be coming up. There's a church in Weirton that has organized a prayer walk, community prayer walk, this Saturday, starting at 9 a.m., and the details of where to meet are a little bit unclear at this time. We're going to try to get that out in various ways this week. We have a rummage sale going on at the same time, but if you're able to join the prayer walk, that would be great. And even if you don't come to a place where multiple people are praying together, walk around your community, or go downtown, park by the Millsop Center and walk around downtown and just pray. Walk in downtown Steubenville and pray. I've told stories before where there's amazing things that can happen when we do things like that. But also, next Sunday, we're going to talk about victory and the new creation, looking forward to the eternal victory, the message of the gospel of eternity that we can share with people. Then we're going to talk about, we're going to have Get the Word Out Sunday, where we talk about the scripture and how we can share the word of God all over the world. Then we're going to have a series called Effective Compassion, where we spend 3 weeks talking about how we might be able to effectively show compassion to people in ways that help more than hurt. And we're going to have VBS, where we reach out to the community and say, we have something good to be a part of here. Experience learning what the armor of God is and who God is. So we've got opportunities to reach our community, but also to be equipped for how to reach our community. Well, let's pray. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this people who have been responsive to your word. And God, I pray for all of these different things that we set before you, that you know exactly what is going on in each and every one of these situations. I see someone's put a dollar bill there. I'm not sure what that means, but perhaps it means that finances are a concern. And maybe this is just a little bit of what someone has, and we say, God, we take this little bit, and even though we don't have much, we say, God, you honored the widow for her mite. When we feel we have nothing to give, take it, multiply it, Lord, and see that we trust you completely. God, I thank you for these people here. Send us your Holy Spirit, please, God. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Those that are in here who have sin to confess, Lord, I pray that they would confess it. Those that are in here that have not made you their Lord, I pray that they would make you their Lord. I pray that they would come before you and say, I want to know you and I want to follow you. I pray that they would say to you right now, Lord, please forgive me. Please adopt me as your child. Please, Lord, be the Lord of my life. I turn from sin. And Lord, I pray that this person would come and find someone to walk alongside them. But God, for all of us, give us your Holy Spirit, Lord, so that we might be empowered in our communities to make a huge difference. Problems that are too big for us, yet you are even bigger, and your ways are beyond what we can understand, too marvelous for us. So God, we trust you. We put it all in your hands. Be with us today, Lord, as we celebrate, as we reflect, as we rest, or as we even work. May any work that is done be to your glory and to your good. We praise you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Go in peace. Have a great day. Happy Mother's Day. Amen.